Hello, this is Dr. Carlo Oger, emergency physician and medical director of Cartersville Medical Center. In this video, we're going to talk about productivity-based compensation for the emergency physician. This video was created for the educational physicians and any other practitioner working in the emergency department, and anyone else who wants to learn about ED reimbursement and how to improve and maximize the revenue generated by the work done. This video is not teaching ways to cheat the system, but to really get back what the providers are entitled to by the work rendered. Let's talk about the MD pay. Until today, our employer would pay us on a set money per hour. This is good because no matter what happens that day, you work the night shift and there are only two people who came that night, you still know what you're going to earn. It gives security in very insecure times. But this is bad because everybody earns the same. Even if one doc killed him or herself throughout the shift and saw 8 more patients than the other guy, he still gets the same money as the guy who shellaxed the whole day. This just creates resentment to the other providers and is not good for patient care. And productivity is good for patient care. It means doctors will see patients faster and more efficiently. There will be less wait in the ER waiting room. There will be less number of patients leaving because they got tired of waiting. It means doctors will be more attentive to getting results timely and push the system so that they can get one patient admitted or discharged promptly so that they can move the next patient and see more. So starting this month, October, we will encourage productivity by adding a productivity component to the hourly pay. This means that you will have X amount of dollars times 38 hours of physician coverage per day, and a 30-day month, that means that X times 38 times 30 will give you the total amount of money put on a productivity pool for us to split. So if everyone in the groups works the same amount of hours and sees the same number of patients, then we should all get the same proportion of that money and everybody still makes the same. Working more hours will increase the total amount you contribute to that pool and the total amount you get from that pool, but the per hour pay will remain equal. So how do you make the per hour pay different than from the other providers? Well, that's what I'm going to attempt to do in this video. Number one, this seems easy enough. See more patients. Simple enough, right? See one more patient, generate one more RVU. Even seeing one more patient per shift over 12 hours, over 12 shifts for the month, will mean that you see 12 more patients than the other physician. If you see 2 more patients per shift, you will see 24 more patients, or the equivalent of working a whole extra shift. Number two, document well. And we're going to spend some time in this one. ER charts are billed according to the level of care provided, from level 1 to level 5. There are specific rules that determine what documentation needs to be present in that chart to evidence a pertinent level of care. For a thorough review of the levels of billing and coding, watch the video linked below. You can click on that. There are 5 levels of care and then an extra level for critical care. And these kind of compares from year to year, but it kind of tells you the RVU or relative value units according to the level of care. And the documentation required for each level. Bottom line is, try to document everything towards a level 5. Our coders will not bill for a level 5 if the acuity is not there or the documentation is not supported. But if you document everything for a 5, then you know you're not going to miss any. For a level 5, you need 4 HPIs, 10 review systems, 2 family or social history, and 8 physical exam systems. Our coders will never upcode charts, but they will downcode the charts if the proper documentation is not present. An incomplete review system can result in a drop in the level of care. Failure to document past medical or social history can have the same effect. Let's talk about the RVU values, and this is some data from 2012. critical care 6.38, level 5, 4.94, and so on all the way to level 1. But if you end up having a chart that was meant to be a level 5, a chest pain admission, the patient has active chest pain, you treat it with nitro and Lovenox, but you didn't document a family social history, or you didn't document enough elements on the history of present illness, then it results in a downcode from a 5 to a 3, which is a loss of 3.1 RVUs. Let's use this as an example, an ocular foreign body, and the reimbursement that Medicare gives us. The location is very important. Most of them are conjunctival or they're corneal. So if it's conjunctival and you use a Q-tip tip to remove it, that's a superficial removal, 1.03 RVUs. But if it's embedded and you have to scratch it off, it's an added RVU, an added cost, an added revenue. In the cornea, if you do the exam with no slit lamp or you do it with a slit lamp, that makes a difference. And if you use the rostering burr, that adds to the RVU. I'm not saying to document or do something that you wouldn't normally do. That's fraud. But if you did them or it needed to be done and you failed to document it, then you failed to provide the documentation for the appropriate billing. Here's another example, nosebleeds. Anterior epistaxis. If you do limited cautery or packings, 1.64, but if you do extensive RVU, percent to the RVU. If you use an ISL tampon, it's the equivalent of extensive cautery or packing, or 2.17 RVUs, separate from the level of care. And posterior epistaxis is almost double the RVU units as anterior epistaxis. Abscess drainage. We do lots of these, and if we improve our documentation, we'll definitely create some increase over time on the RVUs being billed for. Simple or single, a furuncle, a paronychia, superficial, single. If you just dabbed it and it drained, that's fine. But if you have to probe, break loculation, if you have to pack, that's complex. And especially if they're multiple, that adds to that. A simple or single abscess drainage, 2.2 RVUs. Complex or multiple, 4.2, 88% more RVUs. In a typical practice of 80 abscesses per month, it's an additional 1,900 RVUs per year. Laceration repair opportunities. Documentation of location, length, and layers. A 13-centimeter scalp laceration is 3.3 RVUs. A 13-centimeter facial laceration is 4.43, or 25% increase. Length cutoff are 2.6, 5.1, 7.6, and 12.6. Never estimate. Measure. In multiple studies that have been done, it shows that we just don't estimate well enough and often underestimate the length of wounds. That difference can make 25% difference in your coding for laceration repairs. Intermediate repair opportunities qualifies as intermediate, heavily contaminated, extensive removal of debris, layer closures. So, for a 4.5 centimeter chin laceration, simple closure is 2.19. For a layered closure or heavily contaminated, it's 6.41, almost a 200% increase. A simple laceration repair, $44. But if you do it the simple laceration repair through the vermilion border, it's $312, or 9.2 RVUs. Splint reimbursement. In this one, I'm sure we're leaving a lot of RVUs on the table. Long leg, 1.2 RVUs. Long arm, 1.5, etc. Even a simple finger splint can be some RVUs. In a typical group, over a year period, it could be $50,000 left on the table. How about EKG billing? 80% of groups are billing. We provide the definitive service, which is bedside reading, accurate decisions, all the risk. Compliance is even on our side. CMS says that if we provide this interpretation contemporaneously, we can bill. For a typical group, that means $100 more dollars per day. Hey, that would pay for a scribe. Now, the EKG interpretation should be similar to what a specialist would provide, generally met with 3 to 4 separate elements. You need rhythm, axis, ST segments, QRS, and intervals. Now, definitive care is different from just care of a fracture. The ED physician provides the same care as the orthopedics, so it must be the same and not a temporary measure, but the same ultimate care provided by the specialist. So, obviously, a broken femur is never going to be a definitive care, but there are certain fractures which we can provide definitive care for. So let's talk about those. Fingers. You know, if you reduce a fractured finger and splint it, that's it. They don't need anything else. They don't need to go back to the orthopedic doctor. They can be back to their primary care doctor, and not in 1 or 2 days, but in 3, 4, 5 days. So documented that you provided the definitive care for a fractured finger, fractured toe, whether you manipulated it or not, can significantly increase the RVUs for that patient. Clavicle fractures, you know, generally it's nothing to do. Rib fractures, same thing. A nose fracture, they don't need to be referred to anybody, there's nothing to do. So you documented that you provided definitive care for a nasal fracture, a rib fracture, a clavicle fracture, significantly increases your revenue units. Finger, toes, hand, foot, clavicle, ribs, humerus, nose and sternum, wrists, humor, etc. Any fracture that doesn't go to the OR or does not need additional manipulation by orthopedics and don't need urgent follow-up, so if you tell them to follow up in 1 or 2 days versus 5 or 6 days, then that's considered definitive care. When your fracture care note should read something like left ribs, 7 and 8 fracture, plan, pain control, incentive pyrometer, and follow up with your primary doctor, that evidence is definitive care. Nasal fracture, non-displaced, no septal hematoma or bleeding, plan outpatient ENT follow-up, non-urgent, I would write, actually. Here's another way to increase your productivity. Increase the level of supervision of our mid-level providers. Attending documents a clinically meaningful face-to-face interaction with the patient may use the MD's NPI number and it's paid at 100%. If it's only co-signed, then they use the PA's NPI number, which is paid at 85%. This results in an effective loss of RVUs. So, what does the note need to say? The patient has been seen and evaluated by myself and the nurse practitioner. I was directly involved in the care and medical decision making regarding this patient. Patient exams findings include, and you have to do a little summary of your exam, differential, and diagnosis, not just that you saw and supervised the patient. Number 4, complete your charts timely. Charts not completed by the end of the billing cycle will not be included in the RVU calculations and will result in a net loss of your RVUs for that month. Sure, they'll be billed later and the group will still get paid, but it will not be included in your calculations. Number 5, document critical care time when appropriate. Of course, we know that patient that we did CPR on is critical care, or that we gave epinephrine to or dopamine to, but what about acute glaucoma, anaphylaxis that got treated and even discharged? Discharge versus admission does not affect the fact that they were critical patients at some point. AFib with RVR, DKA on an insulin drip, acute MI with STEMI. Now, STEMIs go to the cath lab very quickly, usually way before 30 minutes, but yet you spend extra time reviewing charts, documenting, talking to consultants, reviewing the cath report or cath images. That adds up to your time and surely more than 30 minutes. Pulmonary embolism, pneumothorax, acute limb threatening injury. For example, a fractured dislocation of an ankle that had low vascular flow and you needed to emergently reduce that extremity, that is considered critical care. But also these, critical care top 5 misses. If an agitated patient requires chemical or physical restraints, if you have to transfer a patient to a tertiary center, that's generally critical care. Treatment of an overdose, if you have to give Narcan, acetidote, Bicar. Hypoxia of 87% or less that you put the patient on oxygen, that is a critical intervention. Even acute hypoglycemia, who you gave D52. And treatment of hyperkalemia using IV drugs like calcium gluconate. Always consider critical care for any patient admitted to the ICU. Beware. And here's the big stop to this lecture here. Payments for evaluation and management services. They will be reviewed the extent and potential inappropriate payments for EM services. Medicare contractors have noted an increased frequency of medical records with identical documentations across services. They will review the EM service for the same providers to identify electronic health record documentation practices associated with potentially improper payments. So they are looking at this, looking statistically, is this group billing more critical care than the other people, or more level fives than the other people, or more procedures than the other doctors? Why is that? And make sure it's real. The big one, history of present illness pitfalls. Without four elements, a 99285, a level 5 care, can be downcoded to a level 3. Look at this HPI. Looks pretty good. 47-year-old male person with left side abdominal pain that lasts 12 hours. He reports nausea but no diarrhea. He had a normal colonoscopy years ago but has had no further evaluation since that time. He has since his PMD last week and had a normal exam and basic lab work but was told his blood pressure was high. Looks like a really good note, but it doesn't have four HPI elements, therefore is downcoded and results a 3.2 RVU loss. Those systems with positive and negative responses must be individually documented for the remaining systems, and a notation indicating all other systems are negative is permissible. This refers to review a system. So checking the box, all systems negative except this mark, is allowed, but it's not enough for a level 5. Here's an example. 70-year-old admitted with pneumonia and dehydration. Chart is lacking the required ROAS elements. Should be a level 5, now becomes a level 4. You lost 1.57 RVUs. And look at this review system. Looks really good, but it's not enough. Past family and social history. Levels 81 through 84 require one past family or social history element. But a level 5 requires two of them. Incomplete past family or social history costs you 1.5 RVUs. A patient admitted with CHF should be a level 5, right? But there's no family, no social history. It's coded as a level 4. You lost 3.3 RVUs. I'm sorry, you lost 1.6 RVUs. Here's some basic math. You work an 8-hour shift. You see 2 patients per hour equals 16 patients. You have 3 RVUs per patient. That's 48 RVUs. Or 6 RVUs per hour. Or 1 HPI downcode results in 0.4 RVUs per hour times hours work. You're down 5.6 RVUs per hour. Medical decision components, MDM, amount or complexity of data. Review and summarization of old records gives you 2 points. So if you say old records reviewed, and here's a summary, or his creatinine was the same, or whatever, or a discharge summary, and you provide a brief summary, that gives you 2 points. Obtaining a history from a family member or discussion with a healthcare like a consultant gives you 1 point. Independent visualization of an image. So if you just put the CT report, that's not enough. You got to put individually visualized by MD. Review and order clinical lab tests. So reorder, you do those. You'll get the point. But you review means not just that it copy and paste like our chart automatically imports the data, but you got to write leukocytosis, hypokalemia, or acidotic. That gives you that extra point. Review and order medicine test, discussion of results with the performing physician, and so on. Anyway, that's it. I hope it's extremely useful to you. I hope you use this to increase your productivity and RVUs and not have a missed opportunity for our new productivity compensation. Take care, guys.